Good morning, all of you. So let's get going with the presentation about visual communication skills. This topic is highly important on one side when we need to communicate something. At the same time, it is not part of actual mainstream action. So that's why most of the time it is neglected, according to my observation, and especially when the students are creating some content or presenting their ideas to the faculty members or in a seminar or something. We can see a lot of times that absolutely well written content can go haywire because of bad visual communication. So wrong choice of things can really lead to problems. So in today's session, we are actually going to see about the presentation techniques and use of fonts, colors and all that. I can see that there are some chats coming up and they are unable to see some of the slide. Okay, so slides have a low resolution apparently, and I am told that some people cannot read anything there. So exactly what is the problem? Do you have a problem in color? Some people are saying they are very difficult to read, right? And how about the graphics? So how many people actually have problem with the fonts which I have marked here, right? Lot of people will also find problem with color, highly non-readable at all. Yeah, it's a small size font. People are giving comments about the type of problems. Anything else? Smaller font, yeah, I got that. And background color is horrible, right? There is no contrast, correct. So somebody is pointing out different things, right? Unable to read. So these are two problems. How many people find that this position of the logo is also not very correct? It is chopped from the top. IIT Bombay logo should be seen complete and you should be able to read it, right? Then how many people are scared of this? 137 slides like this? Can you withstand such a presentation for so long? It's not correct, right? Yeah, somebody from Dhule mentioned it is not correct, therefore we cannot read it. Yes, it is horrible. So I was joking actually. I wanted to show how bad presentation slides can really ruin the content. Therefore, I deliberately started with a bad slide. All of you, can you read this slide now? How is this slide? So I am going to talk about the use of text and graphics in most of the documents. Well, I am not restricting this to only presentation, what you make in slides format or any other format, but in general. At the very early stage, I would like to acknowledge the contributions in this presentation done by Dr. Kentaro. He was head of Microsoft Research at the time when I met him, and I saw this great presentation what he had used in his talk, and I requested him if I can borrow some of the slides from his presentation, which he happily agreed, and therefore I am able to use them. This is important. Please note this point. It's okay to get slides and ideas from people you love to, but at the same time, don't forget to acknowledge their content. This is one way of doing it. So let's go ahead. So what's so much big fuss about the font? What's so great about use of font? I don't know how many people have read this article a year back, I think. An Indian student spoke to the US government and told them that if you change your font, your official font of US government is Times New Roman, by the way. They said that if you change that font to Garamond, which is shown down below, then you will save $400 million every year. Now, why is that? It is just because the toner required to print the Times New Roman content versus Garamond content is drastically different. And you can see the results on screen directly. The Garamond font is thinner and that's why uses less toner. But will you agree to this decision? Of course, US government didn't agree to this decision because of the reason that communication is the primary objective of printing. Why do you want to print? You want to print because somebody should be able to read it. Now, you can easily see on screen that Garamond is less readable as compared to Times New Roman. So, at the cost of $400, if the officials are not able to read what is printed, there is no point in saving money. Therefore, importance of font is in its readability. What is so important about design? For example, see this particular slide where a research analysis is comparing two groups. I have no doubt in terms of the authenticity of the data. Data is perfectly fine. Then what's wrong? It's hardly communicating anything. You cannot make out what is being told in this. Only the researcher who has prepared this probably will be able to see and explain what is happening. Otherwise, if I send this slide to anyone, they would not be able to see anything out of this, right? Now, when we see in terms of color, the same logic applies. This is the classroom scenario where slides are used, but look at the colors and the contrast. Can you see this text which is on this gray and white backgrounds? You cannot see white text on white. So, use of a background is very important, and at times you have to take a very clear call about whether you require a background or not. So, that is the thing that we decided that we will focus on these aspects in this small little module about visual communication using text and graphics. Well, I would like to take you back to a smaller but very important component of presentation, which is the process. And typically it should start with the planning phase where you plan a presentation. I am sure it is nothing to do with your visual graphic sense, but planning a presentation is very important. After you plan, then you can decide how do you want to execute it, like what is the outline, what are the details of bullets you are going to add and all that. And finally, you decide on the template which will allow you to change font, color, add graphics and other things, right. Invariably, what people do is follow the reverse process. They start with color schemes and typography, and I have seen people spending a lot of time on the front slide, like what color should they choose, what font should they, what image should be added there. It is absolutely unnecessary amount of time is spent on that, and later on they go to, oh, okay, I think my outline is slightly problematic, so let me change the slide from here to there. And then they go finally to the stage where they analyze, oh, is it really necessary? Do you want these number of slides here, or should I delete them, or such things? Ideal condition is to start with a planning phase where you analyze and you can actually brainstorm the ideas, organize them, go to execute stage, and then finally to the impress stage. We will very rapidly go through these stages. But let me see if you have more questions, I would like to answer them later on. Okay. Now, in the planning phase, one of the techniques which I prefer is about the ideation of the presentation. So, what you want. So, when you have seen, I have taken a popular example of one of the most celebrated and most talented director India has ever produced, Satyajit Ray. So, for output or for a communication what he wanted to create in a film called Ghare Baire, the kind of process he had followed was that in order to get here, he had put lot of effort in the execute stage where he used to have minute detailed worked out, and the planning stage was equally important where if you see his sketches and the notes he has prepared on what the character will look like, how will that character behave, everything is written in detail, even the sideburns will be of this size, how will it that be looking. So, all these details are very well documented in the scanning of the documents which we have received, right. Now, once you have these things in place, then if you put equal amount of effort at the time of execution. So, when the shooting was happening, he used to go there and see to it that every character makeup is done to the perfection. And only then the output comes out something like this, which is world renowned and acclaimed for the finish of the product. So, I am saying that if you follow a particular process with meticulous details, then there is a high probability that it will reach out to the audience and communicate the way it is intended to be communicating, right. So, for a typical presentation, like whatever presentations you would be doing, now here I am slightly digressing, I am not talking about the regular presentations what you make in your class for a particular subject and like 40 series of lectures you prepare for that. This may not apply to that set of presentations, but overall the point is that we all love stories. So, whatever we do, it is very boring if we do not have a story element in anything what we are here, we communicate or something. For example, when I started with that presentation which had no color and very badly used fonts, I suddenly had communication from all of you saying that we can't read it, and that has struck my communication right away. Now I am talking to you instead of you sitting there and listening to me silently. You are equally participating in this presentation, and that makes my point very easy to communicate. Now I am communicating, I am not preaching like one person just saying something and others are just passively listening to it. That is not the case. So, in order to achieve that, we need a story in every explanation what we are trying to make. I do not mean that you have to always talk about the king and the queen and all that, but you need to connect with people with some interesting thing. And what is the story typically? So, if you analyze that, a typical film story goes like this. We have the boy meeting the girl, we have the girl is ignoring the boy and the boy is trying to try something new. There are some plots by the boy to get the girl and the plot will work, and there is happiness ever after, right. This is a standard story. Now, if I translate that to what happens actually at the psychological level, then it is the setup, it is the conflict where the ignorance happens, there is a false climax where we try to see what plots are being worked out by the boy, and there is action because the plot is trying to be made active by the boy, and finally we have everything working out fine. Now, if I translate this thing into any kind of a seminar presentation, how it look like? So, it starts with the introduction where you set up the problem. Okay, this is this thing which was happening in the past. Now, there are these observations that these are the problems right now around this topic, and then there is this related work happening in this area. So, in between this related work, we can see that there is a particular solution which we are proposing, and we can show how this thing works by showing the results and proofs, and finally, we can say that this will work better if we go in this particular direction. Now, this is very much a standard outline of any other presentation what you must have seen, heard or made yourself. And that, why is that? Because this particular type of communication is typical talk outline which will be a pretty good story for people to listen. They love to start off with an introduction because you can't suddenly come into action saying that, okay, here is a problem and here is a solution. Nobody is interested in getting that. Therefore, you need to follow a particular way of storytelling so that people will appreciate the way you have communicated your thoughts. And it is only possible because everyone, including students as well as reviewers who are judging you, will love stories always. That is why we need to see how we can make that outline as interesting as possible so that people would be able to communicate and see whatever is happening and then communicate back to us, right. So, in order to get that position, we need to stress upon the plan phase very much. And one of the techniques I use most of the time is brainstorming. Now, in the brainstorming phase, the ideation is very interesting, and I do not know whether you have tried, but maybe sometime during your next weeks, coming weeks, if you want, you can have a form a small group and try it out at your own remote centers or within your other peer groups, because it is very interesting to see how ideas can generate at the brainstorming level. Well, I will just give you a couple of guidelines about how to conduct a brainstorming session for that matter. So, this has to start with anything which comes to your mind. So it can start with words, concepts, ideas, whatever you think about that topic. You just have to write it down, and you have to just throw them on piece of paper and or a board, or nowadays people just use post-it and keep it there. You can just use a plain sheet of paper also. You don't have to use a very sophisticated equipment for that. And you can also ask one of you to volunteer and write on the whiteboard or a blackboard, whatever is available, and just keep throwing the ideas. Now, the important point at this stage is that you don't have to be judgmental while doing this. So it is very important that you don't decide to discard an idea or to keep an idea being judgmental. No idea should be discarded at this phase. Just keep writing. Later on, when you are done with that time slot of brainstorming, you can find the relationship between the topics. And there, if you find no relationship for a certain point which is written, then you can discard it, but not at the time of when people are suggesting. For example, there is a room of having 5-6 people who are brainstorming on a certain particular idea, and they are saying certain points to be added. The person who is writing, he or she should not comment right away by saying, oh, maybe this is slightly far-fetched, or maybe this is not connected to this, so maybe we should avoid this. Don't take such a judgmental call at that stage. Just keep writing them. After you are done with that, and with the time, we put a time limit so that we don't go endlessly on that. And after that, just try to find out relationship between them. So what are typically the points which will go as an introduction? What are typical points which is about the problem or related work or the solution proof, something like that? Then you should be able to generate a flow out of these buckets which you have collected while brainstorming. So this is an interesting idea, and one of the tools in order to make this is called mind maps. So mind maps will help you in categorizing and analyzing the particular topic of throwing up ideas, and without any hierarchy, so to say. Why I am saying that is because mind map doesn't tell you about a hierarchical structure. So it is, everything is thrown at one point, and then you can just decide the hierarchy later on based on the audience you are going to communicate. So for example, there is an audience which right now when I am talking to you all being teachers, I will reposition my presentation in a way which is different than when I will use the same presentation or the topic when I am talking to students. So these kind of orientation will change for the same content also sometimes. And that is where the structure of the presentation makes a very important role in doing this. So let us take an example here. If you all are there and ready for typing out something, have a look at this slide. You can see some alphabets on screen, right? Now in the alphabets, if I tell you that after period of 35 seconds or 40 seconds, I am going to switch off this slide, and I am going to ask you, tell me number of each of the alphabet in this set what I have shown you. So I want how many A's were there, how many B's, C's and D's and E, F and all that. How will you try to remember this set and recreate it for me? So what could be the technique? Can you try out? I will keep showing this slide. So what is the technique you use? I don't want you to tell me the numbers right now. I just want you to tell me the technique what will you use in order to remember these alphabets and tell me back. So it's kind of a memory test, suppose. How will you do that? Are there some options, ideas? Take a photo. Okay, we can't use technology, by the way, here. I want you to give me a solution which can be used for exam probably. If I give you an exam, you don't have mobile cameras at that time probably, then how will you do this? Yeah, try to construct a sentence. Okay, create a story link. Okay, how can you create a story out of this? We form words, right? So see this. Oh, so you created a word called Maggie out of it, right? Okay, So let me create some words out of it. There is one option that you just count them, that there is one A and 6 E's, 2 C's and all that, and then you can also bring it back, right? There is one option. There is another option where you can create some words, meaningful words, right? So this is one couple of words we can create, and in fact we can also create a sentence out of it. What does the sentence say? A coincidence re-merging unspent. But tell me frankly, how many people can remember this sentence? Very difficult, right? So let me give you another sentence. Can you remember this sentence? A coincidence emergent nurse ping. Can you remember this? Well, even this is very difficult, right? Or if I give you computer science and engineering, well, that would be pretty easy to remember for most of you, because they are associated with this department, or at least they see this nameplate outside everywhere. So it is not a very foreign word for them, like emergent nurse ping. So it depends, the structure depends on the fact of who is going to consume it. Do you agree with this? So it becomes pretty easy for anyone to remember. So now if I tell you, tell me the alphabets from this set, and you will just say, write computer science and engineering and tell me that, okay, all of these are the alphabets, right? This is, by the way, an internet anagram server which helps you in doing this. You can try it out, some very interesting anagrams can be made out of it. Another example, if I tell you, remember this alphabets, mountain comic or account mini ohm or iconic mom nut, very difficult to remember. But if I tell you that this all makes into a word called communication, that is pretty easy to remember, because you know about this word. In fact, the presentation is all about communication. Therefore, it is very easy to remember this. The point I am making, forget about the anagram part, but the point I am making is the structure will always be very pleasing for the users if it comes from their own domain. So the moment it comes from their own domain, the structure is very well appreciated by everyone who is listening to it, seeing it, reading it, reviewing it, whatever they are doing with it. The structure makes an import. So you have to be contextual when you create the structure, so that the users know what is it going to be for them, right? Now going ahead, we should be able to use the brainstormed ideas into various buckets of the presentation, and that will give us a sort of chunking stage where our presentation will be populated by all these topics which we have discussed. So this is one simple solution, and this can be done in using a mind map. Typically when I teach this course in class, we have a full-fledged assignment on a mind map. This time I decided not to go ahead with it simply because of the time factor, as well as the kind of assessment evaluation issues I heard about. Okay, so we will go ahead, and now we will try to see if we can just know a little bit about mind maps. So people who are aware of mind maps should just contribute by posting something about it, but for people who are new to this idea, it is a simple explanation using a central idea and a radial way of explaining things. So the subsections are radial, like a sun rays, you will have everything coming from the center. So later on you can decide the hierarchy by numbering it probably, but it is not like a tree where you will have everything one below the other. So it is a radial design. It allows you to express using visuals. So at times you want to show that this is very important, you can put some stars or you can color it, and all sorts of things are possible. But if you add some of the concept map ideas to it, for example labeling the lines which are connecting to the bubbles, then it will become very informative. By the way, just as a small exercise, these are the mind map guidelines, and there are like 10 points here. But instead of that, if I show you this mind map directly, the same guidelines are explained using this, and this becomes more user friendly for people to understand. So You can use links, you can use color, you can emphasize and add images, and you can have various dimensions to it. You can use keywords, and use of upper and lower will help in giving importance. There can be different styles. You can have a personal style, you can develop from original style which is available, and all sorts of things. So this is pretty easy to remember because of the structure itself. As compared to this 10 bullet slide, this becomes very easy. Even if I have asked this question to a lot of people later on, and they are able to recollect a lot of these guidelines just looking at this mind map as compared to the presentation slide itself, right. So let us move on. But before that, I think there was a question in the last class which I had given, that what is the difference between the concept map and a mind map. So therefore, I just thought I will add one particular slide here. Concept maps are slightly different than mind maps, not majority of a difference, but visible difference is like what you see here. So the connector line between the central idea and the subtopic will also be labeled in concept maps, and it will have some kind of a relationship explanation. So this chooses to do this, or this reflects on this. So you will write that particular summary of that action on the connector line, and that will help you in reading the concept map very fast. So that is the idea. Okay, so we have this difference between mind map and concept map, but let me just tell you a couple of tools which are freely available. Some of them are free, some of them are limited in terms of their usage, but most of them are free nowadays. You have something called Free Mind and X Mind, but there is a tool called Think Buzan. By the way, Buzan is the person who invented mind maps and perfected this technique long time back. So the website which he runs is one of the pioneering effort in this, but it is not completely free, but still you can use limited part of it. And okay, so we have certain part of mind mapping available there. Okay, so from plan stage, let us go to the execute phase, where we want to, now that we have the outline ready with us and we have some topics, let us see how we can use them in a more interesting way. And at this point, I had discussed about use of graphics in the presentation, and I think you have already seen this, so I do not want to spend a lot of time on that. Different type of content will require different type of visuals, and the types of visuals are essentially not cast in stone, but yeah, you can still take this as a reference. What I did not cover in that particular presentation was how you can convert some of the text to graphics to make it more meaningful. And here is one example, and now you all know this is a relational graphic, which was, it will tell you the quantitative difference between whatever is happening. So tables are typically used to explain things, and table will be not much communicative. Instead, if you use a graph of that, that would tell you visually, okay, that the product number 3 has this ratio as compared to product number 2, which has a better ratio. So all these things can be very clear if you use a graph instead of a table. However, there are problems in the way people use graphs or tables. So for example, look at this table. This is about the poverty rates, and there are some the 4 counties are shown here, and the percentage of poverty is shown in the other column. Well, there are some problems in this table. Can you just take a minute to think about what is the problem and try to put it up? Can you all see the table, and what is the problem with this table? Yeah, county is repeated unnecessarily. It is annoying. Okay, decimals are having a problem, right? And you all are pretty correct, because if you show it like this, then it will be much more simpler, because you have the decimals all aligned properly, and then you can do this. In fact, you can go away with word county and just say ABCD here. that also will be better. Yeah, even percentage is sign is not needed if it is there on the top, right? Okay. Now look at this graph. What's the problematic situation here? Font size, axes are not clearly visible. Okay. Font size is the issue. Okay. But font size can be scale is not perfect. Okay. On y axis, I think range in y axis is a problem. Yeah, so I think couple of people are coming up very right. And if I change the scale, I do not actually have to talk about the value up to 50,000. If nothing has reached here, then why to show all these values, right? So I just reduce the y axis to 10,000, and now you know what, I can actually see this particular dip here, which was not visible in the earlier graph at all, that it has dropped down in 1950 below 6000, which was not visible there, right. This is very simple and very common problem, but most of the time people forget to use these techniques in order to explain what they wanted to say, right. I have also covered about color schemes and typography, but I did not cover the visual effects and appeal part. So I had lot of questions from other people about nowadays with so many presentation tools, we have these options of visual effects and transitions and all that. How should we use that? So I just wanted to touch base on that topic briefly, at least before you we go ahead in the final segment of explaining the activity. So when you talk about presentations, so we have these animated text effects, and then we have this kind of windows being used, or we have slides having this door open type of transition. There are many more transitions. In fact, you have something like a blast, and where you can see things getting into pieces. We have something very popular, which is the page curl, and I have seen umpteen number of presentations using this type of a slide. Transition, you have this Venetian blinds, which is becoming very common. Nowadays you have this 3D type of things where you can rotate the boxes and all. You have flying screens. In fact, the range is really crazy. You keep going and you will see that it will really shock you, the some effect of light coming up and some color transition. So the range is really crazy, which will make you think what was the topic of this presentation when it all started, because you are just forgotten by the time I am showing you all these slides what was the over topic when we were starting of this presentation. So let us just unwind a bit. What we wanted to tell you was that whenever you are using a presentation transition, especially in Impress, remember this, that you want the audience to take your message, whatever you are trying to communicate. You want them to take away the message, but you do not want the audience to be taken away by the message. That is not your objective at all. Therefore, the simple Impress guidelines are that do not overdo anything of this. Over transitions, over color, over font usage, over of everything will create a chaotic situation, and that is what I think you can remember. And like in my earlier presentations, even this slide has a green dot, which means that this is the guideline slide, and you can use this slide as a guideline slide, which you can just compress all my presentation slides to one presentation and keep them handy, so that you can utilize it whenever you are in trouble or you want to solve something. Okay. So based on this, we can just have a look at the very famous debate of form and function. What is a form? Is how do you show the message, and what is the function? What exactly is the message? So for example, I ask you that my message or my product I want to envisage is a bunch of bristles to clean or apply. Then what could be the solution for that? What would be your answer? What should be the form of that? If the function is of a bunch of bristles to either clean or to apply something, then what would be the form you would recommend? Can you just type in your answers for that? So if I ask you this question, Yeah, it can be brush. By the way, which brush could this be? Yeah, people are just saying brush after one after another, but yeah, can you be more specific? You cannot be specific because I have not given you the context, and that is why all the answers are ranging in the zone of just a brush, because the moment I say bristles and cleaning, you remember a brush, right. Now, depends on the content, very correctly said by College of Engineering in Guntur, that it depends on the context. So, suppose I give you a context now. Well, so I give you a context that I want something for teeth, something for face and something for paper. Now, what will you use for teeth? Obviously, you will use the toothbrush, right. And what will you use for face? That would be the shaving brush. And most of the women in the audience used to give me the answer that they will use a makeup brush, which is also correct. If I talk about paper or a wall or something, then that would be the painting brushes, right. So, depends on the context that the same product has to be redesigned in order to satisfy the requirement of that particular surface. That is how exactly we should take our decision in terms of presentation, in terms of graphics, in terms of color, everywhere. Depending on the context, we should take a call of what we are going to use. Therefore, it is not that one is important than other, both are important. But if you give less attention or inadequate attention to either of them, then you will not be able to communicate properly. On the other hand, if you give excess attention, then it will lead to a complete chaos, and that is what we should avoid always. Therefore, the content, and this is very important, and that is why it has a green dot, the content for the given audience should govern the decision of choosing what visual you are going to do, use, what design are you going to follow, and what strategy you are going to apply. So, it also depends on that. For example, the moment I am teaching or I am using a view, then I should know that the strategy should be of using the chat which is available here, and then I can interact with you all immediately. So, depends on the audience that how you are going to conduct your communication skills are tested in such conditions very much. I would like to stop here for this particular topic, and I would like to now tell you about the activity you are going to do today, and in between, if there are some questions, I would like to take those. So, questions please.
So, I wanted to know, like I have downloaded some PPTs long back. I don't know the credits. So, how can I give credits to the person who has done?
Okay. So, I will repeat the question. You are saying that you have downloaded some PowerPoint slides from internet and you don't know the source of that. Is it correct? So, how will you give credit for that presentation? So, the website wherever you have downloaded from is also one of the ways you can refer to it. So, if you have downloaded it from, for example, SlideShare, you will come to know that it has been uploaded by X login name. You can refer to that name also. That is also good enough, because sometimes people will anonymously put up some content. So, at that time, you have to refer to the website, but when you refer to it, you have to say in bracket as seen on so and so date on this website. So, that is good enough. Ideally, you should write to the person who has uploaded and ask their permission on an email that I would like to use certain slides from your presentation for this purpose. Can you approve this usage? And if they approve, then you can use it. That would be nice. Otherwise, you have to recreate this and explain it in your own words and then use the content. That is what we have to do. For my slides, you are free to use it because I have released the slides in open source under CC BY-SA. So, which means that you can use my slides and you can, but you have to further release the slides also in the similar license and give attribute to the person who has created, that is me, but also release the slides in the similar license model. so that the flow continues of open source content creation, and we are anyway going to talk about OER in the same sessions. So this is one way of doing it. Purnima College of Engineering.
I have a question. Suppose we have got a presentation being made for subject like microprocessor, where more and more you can say plot diagrams are there, or either mathematics, say another probability and statistics theories. In that, what kind of question we have to take while making the presentation?
Yeah, I have understood the question like this. The question the gentleman is asking is that you have showed me the presentation about communication skills, so that is okay. But what if I have a presentation to make on microprocessor or something on algorithms or some biotechnology subject where there is lot of technical content involved and there is no liberty of like what you were using, various colors and fonts and all that, we do not have that choice. So precisely, sir, what you have asked is very correct, and the thumb rule still goes in the same manner. If you look at the video which I had posted on Moodle, it shows that use of minimum number of fonts and minimum number of colors and using the grid lines in order to have a well designed layout of the slides adds to a cleaner communication any which way, whatever the content in the store. So I would like to give you another example. If you read a novel, especially English novels, then you can see that they are all printed in black and white. There is no color, there are no images, there is hardly any sketch there, but still you can read that. In fact, lot of people tell me that they love to read the novel, but they hate the movie when it is made. So imagine the situation, from that novel they have created a very nice looking movie which all special effects and color and acting and voice and sound and everything, but you still enjoy the black and white novel which you can read, and you are free to visualize or get the message across so nicely. So it depends on the clarity of your presentation rather than clutter of the content. So one thumb rule is that keep it simple, keep minimum number of fonts, minimum number of colors, and have a eye pleasing layout so that the slides look easy. We have another question from Vidya Pratishthan Baramati, I suppose.
Actually, I have information rather the question. Like whenever I am designing an presentation, so I usually use Google's material design. There is something called as Google's material design. So where they have mentioned clearly which color need to be at the background, which color had to be at the front. And along with that, they are given the proper transitions, what type of borders we need to give, what type of shadows we need to give. Google's material design, so they have made it one open for the designer. Actually, they have done it for website and app development. I guess that can be useful for the presentation also.
Thank you very much for sharing this resource. I think it's not a question, but it's a suggestion. So I will repeat for the benefit of other participants who are listening to this. The gentleman from Vidya Pratishthan has come up with a suggestion of using Google material design. So like I was telling in the Moodle video which I have uploaded, that nowadays with the availability of templates, most of the things are already very eased out. However, I see that most of the faculty members don't use the templates, and that's where the things go wrong or start going wrong. So my sincere request is that use a template and copy your entire content. So because the biggest problem what faculty members have is of transporting the content from one presentation to another presentation. You tell me something which can be done in the same presentation, they are very happy to use it. But if I tell them that okay, transport your presentation to this one which has a better template, better layout, better color, better fonts, then that's a lot of extra work to be done. But I feel that it is important to do that, because that will only help you in removing the clutter and using the well-researched guidelines of presentation. And like what you said, these tools are created using these guidelines already. You don't have to really worry about is the font size correct or it has to be changed or something like that. They will automatically get you the font sizes accordingly. Whether it is a second level point, third level point, fourth level point, it will allow you to use it automatically. So that is a good suggestion. Thank you.
There will be a contents and there will be a design. There are two things in presentation.
So like in fact, it tells you that you concentrate on content creation at some point, and later on whenever you are done, you can. So for example, people who are well versed with LaTeX, they will agree to this, because in LaTeX you are completely free from the design part. You just have to keep drawing the content, and if you use the appropriate tags, the presentation will automatically show up in that format. So if it is a heading, it will always show the heading in a particular font and all that. So that's a beautiful way of planning things.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks. We have Marathwada Institute of Technology.
My question is, can you tell me what are the different things in your view that stops students from learning?
So I'll repeat the question for the benefit of the rest of the participants who are listening to this. The question is that what are the different things which will stop students from learning? So first and the foremost is the boredom which accumulates over time. So like I said, if your presentation lacks the engagement pointers in between. So like if you see, every presentation should have a point where the students feel connected to it in some way or the other, and that will only come through participation. So if you are going to create any presentation which has a monologue, like you speak continuously on one side and doesn't bother whether people are sleeping on the other side, then it is definitely stop people from learning. It is observed and well researched fact that students learn, or anybody learns, by participating. So your presentation should have ample opportunity of participation, and that will definitely connect them with this, and they will never stop learning, as you said. So that is one sure shot way. And the second way, in connection to what presentation I just gave, is because of the kind of visuals what you see on screen also creates the boredom at times. For example, if you see something very interesting, then students don't feel like we are not part of it. So every time you show something, if it is catching their eyes in terms of what heading you are giving, what font sizes you are used, if it is too small, people can't read it, then they'll give up and they'll say it's a very boring lecture and I don't want to listen to it. I would rather skip this lecture. So in order to avoid that method, you have to make sure that you attract their attention to the topic you are discussing, and then you can ensure that it stays the same way by introducing participation in every presentation what you are making.
Sir, I would like to know that now there is a lot of research happening based on the learning styles. I think you are showing us how to the visual content. So is there any particular research done on VAK method, like VAK model, no? Visual learners, auditory and kinesthetic? If so, no, in general in India or anywhere across the country, which kind of learners are more, even though it is blended learning? Can you throw some light on this VAK model or learning styles especially, sir?
Okay. So, I will repeat the question for the benefit of others. What are the learning styles typically found in India is part of the question. And I think specifically you asked about the VAK learning. I am really sorry, but I am not very sure about the VAK learning part. But with whatever experience I have in teaching in the classroom, as well as adopting to this style of blended learning which we are right now doing, so I am talking to a large crowd simultaneously, and the MOOCs style of teaching where we don't even talk to people at all. So the only way communication happens is through discussion forums. So I have actually just completed a course on 3D animation, and which I am going to do a formal announcement in tomorrow's session. But just because the topic came up right now, I tried these three teaching styles in the short span of 1 year. Last 1 year I have been doing this activity as a full-time research, and to see the pros and cons of all these three things. And one thing I realized is that without a personal interaction with learner, it is very difficult to communicate or to establish a engagement level with anybody. So we have been brought up in that mode where we cannot connect if we don't have the personal interaction. So however number of channels you have or whatever way you have in order to get information, you still believe that while walking on the street, if you talk to a friend saying that, okay, did this happen in Delhi today, then you are more confirmed about it, even though your internet is telling you, the mobiles are telling you that this is the news of the day. But it is very important when you connect with people, only then you you have a very strong grounded feeling of this. So interaction is the key in any communication, and which is true for education also. So therefore blended mode of learning is emerging very rapidly, and what we at IIT Bombay X are doing is the same thing. So although we have our content in the MOOCs format, we are trying to add the interaction like what we are doing right now in addition to the content dissemination, so that we can solve these queries through either instructor led discussions or peer interaction, so that this can grow. Because it is not possible for me, for that matter, to interact with all 121 remote centers right now, and for that matter to some 3000 participants who are listening to me right now. But because you asked this question, I believe that most of the other people, like 400 people who had this question in their mind, gets answered automatically. At the same time, when during tea or during lunch you discuss with your peers there, this will create a community where you will have interaction built up where there, right. So now I am sure at your institute also, they are not from the same institute, all of you. Ideally it should be that there are people from other institutes also coming and attending at your institute, so that it nurtures the interaction between the teachers on the similar topics. So that is how we are trying to build it up. And so the answer to your question is from the point of view of the methodology which we are adopting in conducting the T10KT workshops and courses. So this is one way of dealing with it. But I would post some of the research material on the discussion forum, so that you can go through it. And I would also request you, so if you have something about this thing, please start a thread on this and start posting it on discussion forum, so that others benefit from the topics which you have so keen interest on. So thank you, and I will go to now the next institute which has a question.
Sir, my question is, you explain about the plan, execute and impress. What we will have to do in impress phase?
What do you have to do in impress stage was the question. Within the plan, execute and impress, the impress stage is more about the look and feel of the presentation. So it talks about what type of color, what type of fonts, what type of layout is to be used in the slide presentations. And it also talks about the transitions which you can use, and so on and so forth. So it is about the look and feel. So impress part is the last part where you decide the overall look and feel of the presentation. Here you are not talking much about whether this slide should come before this and all that. We are not talking about structure, we are not even talking about whether this is the objective of my presentation. All that is done at the plan and the execute stage. In impress, we are only going to talk about the look and feel of the presentation, right. And you can refer to the video and the slides where I have covered this in detail. Let us just take one last question from DY Patil.
Sir, is there any standard that how many bullets we should have ideally in one slide? How many words it should contain?
The question was, is there a standard about how many bullets should be there in one slide, right? So I had answered this briefly in one of the slides. So use the 6x6 rule. There shouldn't be more than 6 points on a slide, and there should not be more than 6 words in each point of these things. More than 6 words makes it very verbose, and people are not able to remember it, right. This is what a very crude level of guideline can be used. Although there can be slides where occasionally you are forced to use some 7 points probably. If your topic talks about 7 important issues related to something, then you may have to add seventh point, but that should be rare according to the researcher, which is given at the bottom. They say that humans cannot remember more than 6 points if they are bombarded onto them. So therefore, avoid more than 6 points on a slide, and within the slide also, it should not be having more than 6 words at that time, right. So thank you very much, have good lunch and the activity after this. I will see you tomorrow at 9:30 a.m.